The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
I'd like to share with you this greeting from Father Albert. This came yesterday morning, I think. Good morning, Monsignor Mike, he writes. Greetings from everyone here. It's now 6:40 a.m. here and getting ready for the day. I will be visiting Bishop Dominic and Bishop Mbinda this week, and there will be another trip to the hospital with Dad before I jet back. It has been a super busy slash hectic time for me, but I am glad to have made my little contribution to the situation here. Thanks very much for what you are doing. I'm looking forward to returning home. Pass my regards to our parishioners. Thank them for their continued prayers. And then about his father. At least the cancer has not metastasized, and we are managing the situation as it is. A very blessed weekend to you all. Father Albert. O God, who manifest your almighty power above all by pardoning and showing mercy, bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and make those hastening to attain your promises heirs to the treasures of heaven. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Numbers. The Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to Moses. Taking some of the spirit that was on Moses, he bestowed it on the 70 elders, and as the spirit came to rest on them, they prophesied. Now two men, one named Eldad and the other Medad, were not in the gathering, but had been left in the camp. They too had been on the list, but had not gone out to the tent. Yet the spirit came to rest on them also, and they prophesied in the camp. So, when a young man quickly told Moses, Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp, Joshua, son of Nun, who from his youth had been Moses' aide, said, Moses, my lord, stop them. But Moses answered him, are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the people of the Lord were prophets. Would that the Lord might bestow his spirit on all of them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
True, all of them just
the priest.
shall I be blameless and innocent of serious sin?
The precepts of the
A reading from the letter of St. James. Come now, you rich, weep and wail over your impending miseries. Your wealth has rotted away. Your clothes have become moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded, and that corrosion will be a testimony against you. It will devour your flesh like a fire. You have stored up treasure for the last days. Behold, the wages you withheld from the workers who harvested your fields are crying aloud, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on earth in luxury and pleasure. You have fattened your hearts for the day of slaughter. You have condemned. You have murdered the righteous one. He offers you no resistance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
With you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
At that time, John said to Jesus, Teacher, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we tried to prevent him because he does not follow us. Jesus replied, Do not prevent him. There is no one who performs a mighty deed in my name who can at the same time speak ill of me. For whoever is not against us is for us. If anyone gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, you will surely not lose his reward. Whoever causes one of the little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands and go into Gehenna, into the unquenchable fire. If your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life crippled than with 2 feet to be thrown into Gehenna. If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. Better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than with 2 eyes to be thrown into Gehenna, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Kind of wide-ranging, and I don't think I can cover the whole thing, but I do have a few things to say about a couple of different parts of it. First, a word about the absurdity of cutting off your hand or plucking out your eye. This is overstatement. It is overstatement for the sake of emphasis. My mother, more than once, said to me, "I'm gonna wring your neck." He never did, but I knew what she meant. Over the centuries, there have been a few people who have taken Jesus' word literally. You don't do that. It'll never be the right thing to do. But what Jesus wants us to understand is, in the first place, there is nothing better or more important in this life, than beginning to live the eternal life that Jesus himself has shown us in his life, and that he invites us to live. It is not money, it is not experiences, it is not possessions or power or prestige. Jesus invites us to value his kind of life, that life which is eternal, over anything else. And so, with these things that he says, he is saying, whatever sin is the thing that you stumble over, whatever it is that trips you up, do whatever you need to avoid it. If you're a recovering alcoholic, you may know that you can't hang out with all your old friends. Some of them will have to be cut off. If your sin is looking at things you should not see, or looking at people in a way you shouldn't, put some controls in place that will limit your exposure to the temptation. Pluck yourself out of harm's way. Now, moving to another part of the gospel. Lee, a friend of mine, is a man of 69 years, going on 70, of course. He's married almost 44 years with Della. When they were married, they were a stunning couple, and they still look pretty good. They have two daughters who are out on their own and still remain close to their mom and dad. Lee has proven himself a capable businessman. He sold his business in molded plastic items for the auto industry a few years ago and retired. But he soon discovered that he needed to work. He needed to be productive in order to keep himself balanced and whole. So now he has acquired a couple of businesses related to one another by those little wood pellets that people heat their homes with or smoke their grilled food with. Lee has had a couple of serious health scares in recent years. He's come through them apparently safe and sound. And he considers that God has blessed him with these good outcomes and other much appreciated blessings. So thoroughly grateful is this friend of mine for his life in its totality, that he says his standard way of responding to the question, "How are you?" is to say, "Blessed beyond words. Blessed beyond words." This response implies gratitude, a sense that a loving creator brought him to being through the love of his parents, and that every natural ability that enables Lee to do well as a businessman, as a husband, as a father, All those qualities and tendencies are gifts from God, gifts that make Lee's life unique and unrepeatable. Of course, the same is true of you and me. Our life itself is the first and essential gift. And the way we use the life given to us is the principal and essential way of expressing our gratitude. The unique gifts that distinguish us from one another, the family that we learn from and share our life with, the abilities that make it possible for us to earn a living and accomplish our work, the interest within us that makes us want to know and learn, the love that impels us to care for one another, it's all gift. And the faith that we have received, the confidence in Jesus that makes us hope for life eternal, this is gift as well. Today's gospel warns us against being stingy with the gift of our communion with God in Christ. When John, who should know better, comes to Jesus and says, there's people trying to do good things in your name, and they don't belong to us. And Jesus has to say to him, that sound bad to you? If they're doing good things in my name, how can they be saying bad things about me? We don't hold the gifts that we have. We are in charge of them in a way, but they are not really ours except to share. We don't hold the faith. Faith holds us and holds us together with one another and with many, many other people. The faith that holds us together is truly ours for the sharing. The work that beckons us because of our faith is ours to share too. Whatever it is that the Lord has given us, is given us for something good. Whatever it is that the whatever good work that is ours to do is something that may invite other people. Is there something in our life that we could be sharing generously with others and that we sort of keep to ourselves? Is there some person, or are there some persons who would benefit from our making our gifts available to them? Something for us to think about, something for us to pray about.